Welcome everyone, Defender for Cloud in the field. Today's episode is quite a special because we are going out of the normal announcements from Ignite to start the first, the second episode of this year, talking about lessons learned from the field. And to do that, we have a very special guest from our European team, Carlos Faria. Carlos, thank you very much for being on.
Thank you, Yuri. Thanks for having me. I've been following the channel since day one, so it's really great to be here.
Awesome. We had Carlos in the past in the Out of the Band edition where he presented his workbook, great work there. But Carlos, can you please give an intro about what you do for Microsoft?
Sure. So essentially, I'm a technical specialist, right? I work in the field with customers. I'm part of the EMEA, what we call the global black belt team, but essentially we are a regional team and we work with customers across Western Europe to help them adopt Defender for Cloud and other Microsoft security solutions.
Excellent. So the conversation, as I mentioned, is about lessons learned from the field. So I would like to start asking you, based on your experience working with customers, why Microsoft Defender for Cloud is such a unique solution when compared to other competitors?
Absolutely. One of the great things about working in the field is that you have this ability to get direct feedback and direct inputs from customers. And I think if I can summarize it, there are two things that really pop up. The first one is the fact that Defender for Cloud is not only a cloud solution, it covers actually hybrid environments. And most of our customers, especially the big ones, are still maintaining some footprints on premises, right? So it's great that the solution can not only cover the cloud, but also can cover other types of scenarios. And while they are setting up this new cloud security operation model for the cloud, they can actually use the same operational processes and procedures to cover also those on-premises environments. The other thing is, I think, the native integration of Defender for Cloud with the XDR platform, right? Mm-hmm. Which is definitely a quick win for customers. Gone were the days where customers were looking for point solutions. I think today they really are looking for a platform that integrates very well with the rest of the portfolio they have. And I would highlight those two as being differentiators for Defender for Cloud.
Great points for sure. And I think one scenario that we discussed the other day is how to fulfill the gap between CSPM and CWPP. So what are your thoughts on that?
Definitely, I think that's perhaps one of the most overlooked capability of Defender for Cloud, which is the fact that we combine Cloud Security Posture Management, CSPM, and Cloud Workload Protection, right? So those two are very well combined in the solution. And even though we hear sometimes customers telling us, hey, we just want to do posture management, actually, when they start to use the product, they realize the benefit of the use cases that having both, right, CSPM and CWP combined provides. And maybe I can give you, one or two examples. Mm-hmm, so if I'm a SOC analyst, for example, right, working as part of the SOC, I get an alert. One of the great things is that I can immediately, without leaving the Defender for Cloud portal or the Azure portal, see that my alert contains a resource, and this resource has certain types of misconfigurations, right? So that's great. The other scenario would be I'm a security architect, I'm responsible for posture or remediation, and I can go to the Defender for Cloud portal, click on a recommendation, and as part of the same experience, I will see if indeed this misconfiguration is being exploited or not, because I have the ability to see if there are alerts or not without having to the same platform, right? Mm-hmm. Maintaining myself in the same portal, which I think is very useful.
Yeah. No, makes a lot of sense. But realistically, when we are talking about our customers nowadays, we've seen a growth of the use of different cloud providers. So realistically, we are talking about a multi-cloud deployment nowadays. So how this affects the usual CSPM lifecycle and how Defender for Cloud fits in at this point?
Yeah, I think it's a great point, right? So definitely we see during the last year, we saw tons of interest on the multi-cloud side. We see customers adopting a multi-cloud strategy. And I think the pain points there is that you have to multiply by 2, 3, or 4, depending on the number of cloud providers you have, the complexity, right, that you have. One of the great things we heard when it comes to Defender for Cloud is that customers who have already invested in Defender for Cloud for Azure, right, and customers who are already using it, they can just keep the same processes, right? They can keep the same experience to start to have visibility over other clouds. And I think with the new multi-cloud provider connectors we have in Defender for Cloud, it's really easy for them to start, you know, embracing this multi-cloud journey. Of course, we're just at the beginning, and I think, you know, in 2022 we'll see more and more of those use cases, and I'm sure, you know, we'll see customers benefiting a lot from that.
Okay, in Azure or multi-cloud, let's say the life cycle, you start remediating the recommendations. Now that you have all the homework done from the preventative standpoint, it starts by enhance the secure score. You go through the journey. You reach a point where you're ready to start work on also on the reactive manner, and then it comes the detection aspect to the CWPP, as you mentioned, which usually is handled by SOC, as you also emphasize. Now, what you've seen in the field regarding how SOC is leveraging Defender for Cloud?
Yeah, I think that, you know, this is really a big value proposition of Defender for Cloud. When I talk to SOC teams, I often hear the fact that it's really challenging, right? Because, you know, SOCs are usually overwhelmed. They are overloaded with the amount of work they have. And especially for cloud environments, which are quite highly dynamic and, you know, rapidly changing type of environments. So it's really hard for the SOC to adapt frequently and rapidly to this type of environment, especially because most of the time they don't have the knowledge as well. Mm-hmm. So just by enabling Defender for Cloud, we see customers telling us, hey, it's great because now we can cover, you know, 100 use cases for platform as a service just by enabling the solution, right? And maybe from there we can then, you know, start to customize, build our own use cases. So it really provides a great return on investments. And for a SOC analyst, right, which usually struggle with having to understand how Kubernetes work, right, how, you know, platform as a service type of services operates, yep, it provides a great return on investment.
Excellent, Carlos. Thank you very much. That's a really unique perspective that Carlos is bringing from his interactions in the field. But let's shift a little bit and show a demo. It looks like you have a demo to show with some best practice as well.
Exactly. So if we go back to the conversation we were having, right, on the different types of integrations between CSPM and CWP, this is just an example, right? So let's start with CWP or threat detection in general. And here I'm in the Defender for Cloud portal, right? I just select an alert that is coming from one of my resources. In this case, it's an on-premises SQL server, and it's telling us that there is an unusual number of failed signing attempts, right? Mm-hmm. So if I go into this alert, I expand and I start the investigation experience. I have, of course, details about the alert. But one of the cool things is that if I click here, I immediately can see, as part of the investigation experience, right, that this resource has this type of misconfigurations, right? Again, just an example on how powerful it is to have the ability to, you know, from one side, the CWP side, having visibility over the CSPM side. The other way around also work, right? So if I go back to Defender for Cloud, if I go into the inventory section, right, which will tell me all my resources and how they are from a posture perspective, if I click on the resource itself, I can immediately see what's the posture of the resource, of course, with the summary, right, with all the recommendations. But you might notice here this alert pane, right? So I can really pivot and understand what type of, you know, threat detection alerts have been triggered. And this gives me the ability to correlate the misconfigurations with maybe how this resource is being exploited or not, without having to go to my SIEM platform, for example, to go to Sentinel or another SIEM. I just stick with the Azure portal and the Defender for Cloud solution. Finally, you know, I think during the last year we've been enhancing our posture management capabilities, and one of the, you know, greatest capabilities we've introduced is the ability to create workbooks, right, in the Defender for Cloud solution. So I think we've been talking about, you know, how customers do posture management. One of the requirements we hear the most is, you know, how do I keep track of the progress of my posture management efforts, right? Not only having the ability to have a point in time view, right, a snapshot of my posture, but having the ability to keep track on how this is evolving. And workbook is a great way to build this type of dynamic, right? So we provide one of the out-of-the-box workbooks in Defender for Cloud. It's called Secure Score Over Time. And I really can keep track of, you know, all the changes that are happening in my environment. I can see the progress. If I click on one of the recommendations, I can immediately see, you know, how my resources are going from being healthy to unhealthy, right? And I can do this weekly, on a weekly basis, on a daily basis. It's really up to me, but at least I have, you know, a way to keep track of those things in the portal. Finally, we talked a bit about multi-cloud, right? So one of the investments we've made recently is having the ability to provide multi-cloud connectors for Defender for Cloud. So that means that if I go into the inventory section of the solution, once I have the connector set up, I can not only filter by, you know, Azure, but I can also bring recommendations and, you know, resources from, again, my on-premises environment, my AWS accounts, and also my GCP accounts, right? Which I think is very powerful because, again, if I'm already used to leverage Defender for Cloud to do posture management, I can now rapidly start to do the same for other clouds. So hopefully that kind of summarizes some of the points we've been discussing, Yuri, during the discussion today.
Oh yeah, yeah. I think those three visualizations that you present is very important. I'm a big fan of the first one, which is fulfilling the gap between CSPM and CWPP. As I said many times, every time that we have an incident, we have to learn from that incident, and many times the learning must be passing on the options to enhance the security posture on the preventative measure. So that's how you get a reactive alert, use that alert to learn what needs to be improved, and then move on to pass to the security posture management team, because it's usually a different team to implement those measures. So great great point there, great point on the inventory, all good stuff. All right, so do you have any final considerations or top three lessons that you learned working with customers in 2021 so we can wrap up?
Yeah, well, I would say, if I can summarize it, I think, you know, CSPM should not be a big project for customers, right? We see that customers who have actually started to use Defender for Cloud without, you know, making it a big, big, big project or more successful, because it's really easy to do CSPM, right? You just start with Secure Score, and from there, it's continuous improvement, right? And 100% security does not exist. I think it's more about, you know, starting now and making it happen. And also, you know, enabling Defender for Cloud for past services, right? As we discussed, for the SOC, it provides a huge, huge, huge type of value. And finally, I think, you know, starting to look into multi-cloud, right? I think it's definitely a tendency going forward, and I'm looking forward to what 2022 will bring in that area with customers.
Awesome, Carlos. Again, thank you very much for your time, for preparing the demo and to share your insights. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I'm the one to thank you for the opportunity to be here. Thank you, Yuri.
Thank you. All right, everyone. Thank you very much for tuning in. If you are not subscribed for the Microsoft Security Channel, make sure to follow the link below. Click on it. It's our playlist, Defender for Cloud in the Field playlist. Click on that and subscribe. And see you again next time.